My name's Chaz, and I'm going to be talking to you today about Windows Defender Application Guard. So we're going to start by talking a little bit about the threat landscape, but how that landscape has led Microsoft to invest in this area to define a containerization strategy for client to be able to protect against these attacks. I actually have a working demonstration that I'll show you. That's using a Windows 10 build that's only a few weeks old. And I'm going to talk about the container technology that makes all this happen. And then we'll have a little section at the end for question and answer. And I do have, for those that stay till the end and have a thought-invoking question, I do have a couple hats here that I'll be happy to give away. So we all get this. The evolution of attacks have created a situation where the internet just really isn't all that safe. When we put it in the context of the enterprise, it really is about how can an enterprise allow their users to be able to browse to internet sites that they want to go to and still feel that the enterprise is safe from not being attacked at that time because they can't be everywhere. You know, we are seeing the sophistication in both organized crime and nation state are almost starting to equalize as the motivations become more real. Ransomware has been all over the news in the last year, as I know you all know, right? That's a serious threat. Enterprises have been significantly affected by that. So we need, you know, some defense to be able to deal with these attacks. You know, the reality is these attacks happen fast. They're hard to stop. Brad talked about in his keynote on Tuesday that, you know, it's still 90% of the intrusions that happen, the attack vector by which the attackers get in is through a phishing mail. You know, whether it's giving up your creds or whether it's actually running attack on the browser itself or maybe in another application, that's just the reality. You know, we see these kind of numbers from the Verizon data breach report. 30% of the users that get these mails open them up. And then you get 12% that actually will click or still open up the document, and they're all going to do it in less than 5 minutes of that group. So that's the reality. So we need to come up with a way to defend against that. The good news is the playbook that the attackers use is well known to us, right? So they use the same tactics and techniques, which allows us to come up with a defense. So, you know, we get it. It's a phishing attack usually, and that's the way that they're going to get the foothold on the machine because the user clicks, and we're going to run through an example here. You know, the next thing they do is once they've established the foothold, they really want to expand their footprint on the network, right? So they're going to use credential theft to elevate their privileges and move across the network. And ultimately, you know, depending on how your security architecture is for the enterprise, you're going to lose your domain. And then all this stuff is too real, and we understand that well. It's a serious impact to businesses. It's very costly. I think Brad even talked about $3 trillion in losses. So let's take a look at, you know, a real attack. So the Strontium attack is Microsoft's internal classification for APT 28. You know, these guys craft mails that are specifically designed to get the attention of their target audience. You know they're going to want to click on these mails. They're getting better and better at this, and only a security pro like us is really going to drill in on this link and go, wait a minute, this doesn't really go to the NATO.int site, right? Oftentimes, that hyperlink is just going to be linked anyway, and the user can't even see it. So we know 12% of the users are going to click on that thing, and then what happens next is they're going to go to a site that the attacker owns. And we know what happens next. I mean, if the attacker owns the site, they're going to go ahead and let their exploit payload run. If the browser is vulnerable to that, then they're going to get that foothold established, and the user gets redirected then to the real site. That all happens so fast, the user really doesn't even see it. So what's the issue? These attacker websites are getting better and better, and they just look like the normal website while you're getting redirected, and a standard user has no idea that there's all this cruft that lies behind that site. The impact is real. So, you know, issues that we see are enterprises equipped to be able to actually mitigate that attack? How do they get those attackers out of their network once they're there? And how do they know they've got a trustworthy enterprise, you know, once they've actually maybe flattened and rebuilt all that, and it's very expensive? So what we want to do is change the playbook. We want to stop these attacks, you know, more leftwise on the kill chain before they actually get in, and then you're in a post-breach kind of a situation. So the way we're thinking about this for Microsoft is we've got three pillars, so our protection, detection, and response. And you know, with Protect, we really want to have investments that we're making to secure the endpoints themselves. When that fails, you need to be able to detect if there's something going on in the enterprise. And then finally, being able to have a response that actually can mitigate and deal with those attacks and try to ensure that they don't happen again. So when we talk about Windows in particular, starting in Windows 7, we actually started making investments in ways that we could start to harden the Windows client endpoint. So you saw things like the Trusted Platform module, BitLocker, BitLocker to go, and you saw Smart Screen added into IE, and we have that for Edge as well. And that's really using the power of the cloud for Microsoft to inform a user when they're visiting a site that may not be a trustworthy site in the first place. Now in Windows 10, you'll see a lot more technology added to really, again, secure the endpoint. So we see things like Windows Trusted Boot, Windows Defender, and Windows Defender ATP. When you have a modern device, then you're able to take advantage of even more. And that's what we're talking about today, virtualization-based security. So how can we actually isolate these threats from the host to prevent the attacker from getting a foothold in the first place? That's really the goal. So what's driving us to this point? We're actually seeing data collected internally at Microsoft of exploits in the wild that are attacking the kernel. So we're seeing attackers moving down the stack, and they're focusing their energy, frankly, where they can get the most bang for the buck. And this is a dramatic increase, and this is what's led us to coming up with more virtualization strategies to isolate the host from untrusted behavior. So the issue at hand is that the traditional platform stack has no way to defend against a vulnerability within an application running on that stack. Attackers are able to pretty easily get out of that application and then elevate a privilege and basically take over the whole machine, and that gets them that foothold. And that's what we're trying to stop with these technology investments. So the first step along the way is something called virtual secure mode. And VSM basically gives us a way to isolate those components in the OS that are actually the most sensitive, which can include the secrets of the user, the enterprise credentials, in this case for Credential Guard. We also have Device Guard. So the way we think about this is we want to defend what's inside this container from attackers that might be on the machine trying to access the secrets. You can learn more about Device Guard and Cred Guard by actually going around the corner. We actually have our device security pod right behind me after the talk. And now the next step in the evolution is what we're here to talk about today, and that's Windows Defender Application Guard. So again, we're building upon our container technology and our virtual security, and now we're going to create an isolated environment where the user can browse to the internet, but they can do it in such a way that if something does happen inside that container, it's isolated from the host. So we almost think of this as a jail. We want to ensure whatever happens in that container can't break out of that jail and get onto the client. So now let's go back and look at the Strontium attack, but now if you're running Windows Defender Application Guard for Edge inside the environment. So again, the user's still going to get that mail. 12% of the users are going to click on that mail. But because we're running Application Guard in the enterprise administrator has actually defined what sites they trust. And if they don't trust a site explicitly, it's going to be opening up in Application Guard. So in this case, the user's going to browse to that page. But because Windows has Application Guard, you'll see at the top left, there's a little tab there in orange. This is now that isolated environment that you saw in the diagram. So whatever the user does inside this orange container stays within that container, and it can't get out onto the host. In this case, that attack runs. Maybe Edge had a vulnerability because it was a zero-day attack. It doesn't matter because whatever happens, including a kernel mode attack, is isolated in that container. When the user closes that session and signs off, that all goes away, and the enterprise host is unaffected by that. All right, so now I'm going to show you actually a demo of working Application Guard, like I said, on a version of Windows that's only a few weeks old. So I'm going to start with Edge. So I have Edge, and the enterprise here has decided that the Edge start page is a trusted page. So it's not in the container. You don't see that orange marking on the page itself. So I'm going to go ahead and navigate to a site that I know is not on our site list, which is msn.com, in this case, just for the demo. And you can see Application Guard started up. And now MSN is going to be rendered inside that container, completely isolated with Hyper-V from the host. We've added in some things to help users understand that they're in a container, because we get it that not all users within the enterprise are going to understand what this new isolated environment is about. So if they actually click on that top left tab, they can click Learn More, and then we'll have a page that they can actually learn more about Windows Defender Application Guard. So they can click on these, and you know, we have short descriptions of what it's all about, including it helps defend against malware that they might encounter on the internet. And that's it for the demonstration. I will say we do have support for being able to print from the container. You can also use the clipboard, and you can cut and paste between the container and the host. So functionality that we think that users would still want to have, even though they're in the container, we want to make sure that's available. So let's take a look at the client container technology that makes all this possible. So what we've done is we've actually leveraged the work of the server container team within Windows to take what they've done for Docker and scenarios like that and take those containers and bring them onto the client and to be able to use those for security. So kind of to dive in a little bit for you guys to be able to see this. So what happens in Windows Defender Application Guard is that first step, the enterprise admin needs to set up the site list, and they do that through a network isolation policy. Once they've built that site list, they propagate that through the enterprise, and it gets into a policy store. Now, if you go back and walk the demo that I did, I was here on the host browser running Edge. I typed in msn.com. The notification of the new URL comes into our management component that we have for Application Guard. That then just checks that site list to see if that URL is on that list or not. If it's not on the list, then the lookup fails, and we're going to inject Edge into the container. So the important thing to see here is in this container, it's completely isolated to include the kernel and the Windows platform service. This is why we're able to defend against the kernel mode attacks, where we saw that big uptick in the last 2 years, and that the host is unaffected by anything that happens in here because we're running on Hyper-V and using Hyper-V virtual switch to be able to do that. So you might be asking, how can you get your hands on this and try it out? There's two ways that you can do that, and it's going to be available in Redstone 3, and you can get it through our Microsoft Technology Adoption Program and also Windows Insider. But it is required that you're running the Enterprise SKU E3 edition to be able to use this. So if you're an insider and you run Enterprise, you'll be able to see the feature. To be in TAP, if you're not familiar, there are some requirements, and you can take a look at those here. If you want to know more about TAP, if you're not a TAP customer already, go to OSNext at Microsoft.com. Send a mail there. We'll respond to you and let you know if your company is suited to be a good TAP customer. So I know I ran through that fairly quickly, but I'm happy to take some questions at this time. Let me just get this mic on.
I'm not a business owner or anything. I'm a student, so I just had a question. I want to get into penetration testing, and say that, you know, if I speak to you, and is there a way for people to get into a bug bounty? Do you guys offer like a bug bounty for this?
That's a great question. So the question, if you didn't hear, is for like a student or somebody, like a researcher, is there going to be a bug bounty for this? We've been discussing it. We haven't made a decision on it yet. But, you know, we recognize the value of a bug bounty on a technology like this, especially if we're going to be making a security guarantee. So stay tuned on that. We will make it available. We have a blog, actually. So if you go to look at Microsoft Edge blog, and if you look for Application Guard, you'll see pretty much everything I talked about is there. So that is a great question. And you already have a hat, so I'm going to replace your hat with a Windows hat. Yeah.
So is this technology able to identify malicious PDF or Word attachments in the email, or just the link?
Yeah, good question. So we don't actually identify whether or not, you know, document attachments are malicious. Um, it, in the version we have now, it's really about edge isolated in the container for when the user is out on the internet. We're not going to be isolating documents at this point. However, if the user goes and downloads a malicious Acrobat file, Edge actually will render that now. So I don't know if you've seen that in Edge. So if there's a problem, it just stays within the container. If you're, same thing with a Word document, it'll need to be opened up into like Word online. We don't actually have Office within the container in this version. So.
So like, if the user clicks on that link and immediately some macro is getting downloaded or some malicious JavaScript is being executed, so will it prevent that from executing or will it let it run?
It doesn't stop the execution from happening. In fact, that's the whole point of the design is whatever happens in the container can go ahead and run in the container. We are looking at Windows Defender Advanced Threat Protection, ATP, and figuring out how we can actually integrate that within Windows Defender Application Guard, because that then would get you that same level of reporting so you could see those attacks that are happening within the container. So, good question. Yes, sir.
The container will avoid that the user can download files to the systems that will be blocked. Let's say I can go to a website in the container that is not in an enterprise,
right,
but I can download a file which that could be infected anyway. So that file, what happened with that file?
Yeah, so the way that we would block against that is using Smart Screen. So Smart Screen will actually run within Edge, and it'll still notify the user that that site is been marked as a malicious site or that there's an issue potentially with a file they're trying to download that doesn't have a high degree of trust. So that all works. But Application Guard, again, will just, if the user goes ahead to that site or they click on that document, it's opening in isolation. So the enterprise machine is not affected by that.
How do you guys identify the day zero malware or ransomware? Does user be prevented to, execute within the container or not?
Yeah, so specifically we've designed it to defend against a zero day, but it'll require Windows Defender ATP, which is an E5 upgrade, once we have that integrated in to be able to identify that there was something malicious in the container. So the way it's designed now, it really is kind of a fire and forget. It's like whatever happens in the container stays in the container, it's not going to escape. But we understand that enterprises want insights into that. They want to know what's going on in the container. So, was there another hand up that I missed all the way in the back?
I think you answered part of it already. So the question was, how do you really see whether that site is legitimate or not? Because one way is to check for the certificates, but that wasn't really a REST-eBPS site. That was just a normal site, so there was nothing to compare against the certificate authority, certificates or something.
Right. Yeah, so it's really up to the administrator to determine what sites they're going to trust. And yeah, there's two schools of thought on that. I think there's going to be, one school of thought is you're going to be limited in what sites you put on the corporate resources list for that site list, and everything's going to open in the container. Or you're going to have a more exhaustive approach that you're going to put sites that your users tend to go to on the internet, that it's okay for them to do that in the browser and you trust those sites. And then only truly the malicious stuff opens up in the container. So you're really just using the technology where it's needed most. So anybody have a last question? I'll give the hat to the last question here. Yes, sir. If you want the hat, it's up to you. Oh, you're good. Anyone else? No, well, thank you very much for attending. And I know you asked a question, so I'll shoot it right over here. Thank you very much. And again, if you want to learn more about the technology, please check out the Edge blog. Thank you very much.